This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book A Budget of Christmas Tales by Charles Dickens and Others. STAVE 1. Marley's Ghost. Marley was dead to begin with. There is no doubt whatever about that. The register of his burial was signed by the clergyman, the clerk, the undertaker, and the chief mourner. Scrooge signed it. And Scrooge's name was good upon change for anything he chose to put his hand to. Old Marley was dead as a doornail. Scrooge knew he was dead. Of course he did. How could it be otherwise? Scrooge and he were partners for I don't know how many years. Scrooge was his sole executor, his sole administrator, his sole assign, his sole residuary legatee, his sole friend, and sole mourner. And even Scrooge was not so dreadfully cut up by the sad event, but that he was an excellent man of business on the very day of the funeral, and solemnized it with an undoubted bargain. The mention of Marley's funeral brings me back to the point I started from. There is no doubt that Marley was dead. This must be distinctly understood, or nothing wonderful can come of the story I am going to relate. Scrooge never painted out old Marley's name. There it stood years afterward above the warehouse door, Scrooge and Marley. The firm was known as Scrooge and Marley. Sometimes people new to the business called Scrooge Scrooge and sometimes Marley, but he answered to both names. It was all the same to him. Oh! But he was a tight-fisted hand at the grindstone Scrooge, a squeezing, wrenching, grasping, scraping, clutching, covetous old sinner. Hard and sharp as flint, from which no steel had ever struck out generous fire, secret and self-contained and solitary as an oyster. The cold within him froze his old features, nipped his pointed nose, shriveled his cheek, stiffened his gait, made his eyes red, his thin lips blue, and spoke out shrewdly in his grating voice. A frosty rime on his head and on his eyebrows and his wiry chin. External heat and cold had little influence on Scrooge. No warmth could warm, no wintry weather chill him. No wind that blew was bitterer than he, no falling snow was more intent upon its purpose, no pelting rain less open to entreaty. Foul weather didn't know where to have him. The heaviest rain and snow and hail and sleet could boast of the advantage over him in only one respect. They often came down handsomely, and Scrooge never did. Nobody ever stopped him in the street to say with gladsome looks, "My dear Scrooge, how are you? When will you come to see me?" No beggars implored him to bestow a trifle, no children asked him what it was o'clock, no man or woman ever once in all his life inquired the way to such and such a place of Scrooge. But what did Scrooge care? It was the very thing he liked. To edge his way along the crowded paths of life, warning all human sympathy to keep its distance, was what the knowing ones call nuts to Scrooge. Once upon a time, of all the good days in the year on Christmas Eve, old Scrooge sat busy in his counting house. It was cold, bleak, biting weather, foggy withal, and he could hear the people in the court outside go wheezing up and down, beating their hands upon their breasts and stamping their feet upon the pavement stones to warm them. The city clocks had only just gone three, but it was quite dark already, it had not been light all day, and candles were flaring in the windows of the neighboring offices, like ruddy smears upon the palpable brown air. The door of Scrooge's counting house was open, that he might keep his eye upon his clerk, who in a dismal little cell beyond, a sort of tank, was copying letters. Scrooge had a very small fire, but the clerk's fire was so very much smaller that it looked like one coal. But he couldn't replenish it, for Scrooge kept the coal box in his own room, and so surely as the clerk came in with the shovel, the master predicted that it would be necessary for them to part. Wherefore the clerk put on his white comforter, and tried to warm himself at the candle, in which effort, not being a man of strong imagination, he failed. "A Merry Christmas, Uncle." "God save you," cried a cheerful voice. It was the voice of Scrooge's nephew, who came upon him so quickly that this was the first intimation he had of his approach. "Bah," said Scrooge. "Humbug." He had so heated himself with rapid walking in the fog and frost, this nephew of Scrooge's, that he was all in a glow, His face was ruddy and handsome, his eyes sparkled and his breath smoked again. "Christmas a humbug, uncle," said Scrooge's nephew. "You don't mean that, I am sure?"
"I do," said Scrooge.
"Merry Christmas.
What right have you to be merry? What reason have you to be merry?
You're poor enough."
"Come then," returned the nephew gaily.
"What right have you to be dismal? What reason have you to be morose?
You're rich enough."
Scrooge, having no better answer ready on the spur of the moment, said, "Bah," again, and followed it up with, "Keep Christmas in your own way and let me keep it in mine."
"Keep it," repeated Scrooge's nephew.
"But you don't keep it."
"Let me leave it alone then," said Scrooge.
"Much good may it do you.
Much good it has ever done you.
There are many things from which I might have derived good, by which I have not profited, I dare say," returned the nephew, "Christmas among the rest. But I am sure I have always thought of Christmas time, when it has come round, apart from the veneration due to its sacred name and origin, if anything belonging to it can be apart from that, as a good time, a kind, forgiving, charitable, pleasant time, the only time I know of, in the long calendar of the year, when men and women seem by one consent to open their shut-up hearts freely and to think of people below them as if they really were fellow passengers to the grave, and not another race of creatures bound on other journeys. And therefore, uncle, though it has never put a scrap of gold or silver in my pocket, I believe that it has done me good, and will do me good, and I say God bless it." The clerk in the tank involuntarily applauded. Becoming immediately sensible of the impropriety, he poked the fire and extinguished the last frail spark forever.
"Let me hear another sound from you," said Scrooge, "and you'll keep your Christmas by losing your situation.
You're quite a powerful speaker, sir," he added, turning to his nephew.
"I wonder you don't go into Parliament."
"Don't be angry, uncle.
Come,
dine with us tomorrow."
Scrooge said that he would see him, yes indeed he did.
He went the whole length of the expression, and said that he would see him in that extremity first.
"But why?"
cried Scrooge's nephew, "why?"
"Why did you get married?" said Scrooge.
"Because I fell in love."
"Because you fell in love," growled Scrooge, as if that were the only one thing in the world more ridiculous than a Merry Christmas.
"Good afternoon."
"Nay, uncle, but you never came to see me before that happened.
Why give it as a reason for not coming now?"
"Good afternoon," said Scrooge.
"I want nothing from you, I ask nothing of you, why cannot we be friends?"
"Good afternoon," said Scrooge.
"I am sorry with all my heart to find you so resolute. We have never had any quarrel to which I have been a party. But I have made the trial in homage to Christmas, and I'll keep my Christmas humor to the last. So a Merry Christmas, uncle."
"Good afternoon," said Scrooge.
"And a Happy New Year."
"Good afternoon," said Scrooge.
His nephew left the room without an angry word, notwithstanding. He stopped at the outer door to bestow the greetings of the season on the clerk, who, cold as he was warmer than Scrooge, for he returned them cordially.
"There's another fellow," muttered Scrooge, who overheard him, "my clerk, with 15 shillings a week and a wife and family, talking about a Merry Christmas. I'll retire to Bedlam." This lunatic, in letting Scrooge's nephew out, had let two other people in. They were portly gentlemen, pleasant to behold, and now stood, with their hats off, in Scrooge's office. They had books and papers in their hands, and bowed to him.
"Scrooge and Marley's, I believe," said one of the gentlemen, referring to his list.
"Have I the pleasure of addressing Mr. Scrooge, or Mr. Marley?"
"Mr. Marley has been dead these 7 years," Scrooge replied.
"He died 7 years ago, this very night.
We have no doubt his liberality is well represented by his surviving partner," said the gentleman, presenting his credentials.
It certainly was, for they had been two kindred spirits. At the ominous word liberality, Scrooge frowned and shook his head and handed the credentials back.
"At this festive season of the year, Mr. Scrooge," said the gentleman, taking up a pen,
It is more than usually desirable that we should make some slight provision for the poor and destitute, who suffer greatly at the present time. Many thousands are in want of common necessaries. Hundreds of thousands are in want of common comforts, sir.
Are there no prisons? Asked Scrooge.
Plenty of prisons, said the gentleman, laying down the pen again.
And the union workhouses?
Demanded Scrooge.
Are they still in operation?
They are.
Still, returned the gentleman, I wish I could say they were not.
Under the impression that they scarcely furnish Christian cheer of mind or body to the multitude, a few of us are endeavoring to raise a fund to buy the poor some meat and drink, and means of warmth. We choose this time because it is a time of all others, when want is keenly felt and abundance rejoices. What shall I put you down for?
Nothing,
Scrooge replied.
You wish to be anonymous?
I wish to be left alone, said Scrooge.
Since you ask me what I wish, gentlemen, that is my answer. I don't make merry myself at Christmas, and I can't afford to make idle people merry. I help to support the establishments I have mentioned. They cost enough, and those who are badly off must go there.
Many can't go there, and many would rather die.
If they would rather die, said Scrooge, they had better do it and decrease the surplus population.
Besides, excuse me, I don't know that.
But you might know it, observed the gentleman.
It's not my business, Scrooge returned.
It's enough for a man to understand his own business, and not to interfere with other people's.
Mine occupies me constantly.
Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Seeing clearly that it would be useless to pursue their point, the gentleman withdrew.
Scrooge resumed his labors with an improved opinion of himself, and in a more facetious temper than was usual with him.
At length the hour of shutting up the counting-house arrived. With an ill will, Scrooge dismounted from his stool, and tacitly admitted the fact to the expectant clerk in the tank, who instantly snuffed his candle out and put on his hat.
You'll want all day tomorrow, I suppose, said Scrooge.
If quite convenient, sir.
It's not convenient, said Scrooge, and it's not fair.
If I was to stop half a crown for it, you'd think yourself ill-used, I'll be bound.
The clerk smiled faintly.
And yet, said Scrooge, you don't think me ill-used when I pay a day's wages for no work.
The clerk observed that it was only once a year.
A poor excuse for picking a man's pocket every 25th of December, said Scrooge, buttoning his great coat to the chin. But I suppose you must have the whole day. Be here all the earlier next morning.
The clerk promised that he would, and Scrooge walked out with a growl. The office was closed in a twinkling, and the clerk, with the long ends of his white comforter dangling below his waist, for he boasted no great coat, went down a slide on Cornhill at the end of a lane of boys 20 times in honor of its being Christmas Eve, and then ran home to Camden Town as hard as he could pelt to play at blindman's buff.
Scrooge took his melancholy dinner in his usual melancholy tavern, and having read all the newspapers and beguiled the rest of the evening with his banker's book, went home to bed. He lived in chambers which had once belonged to his deceased partner. They were a gloomy suite of rooms, in a lowering pile of building up a yard, where it had so little business to be, that one could scarcely help fancying it must have run there when it was a young house, playing at hide-and-seek with other houses, and have forgotten the way out again. It was old enough now, and dreary enough, for nobody lived in it but Scrooge, the other rooms being all let out as offices. Every room above, and every cask in the wine merchant's cellars below, appeared to have a separate peal of echoes of its own. Scrooge was not a man to be frightened by echoes. He fastened the door and walked across the hall and up the stairs, slowly too, trimming his candle as he went. Half a dozen gas lamps out of the street wouldn't have lighted the entry too well, so you may suppose that it was pretty dark with Scrooge's dip. Up Scrooge went, not caring a button for that. Darkness is cheap, and Scrooge liked it. But before he shut his heavy door, he walked through his rooms to see that all was right. Quite satisfied, he closed his door and locked himself in, double-locked himself in, which was not his custom. Thus secured against surprise, he took off his cravat, put on his dressing gown and slippers and his nightcap, and sat down before the fire to take his gruel. As he threw his head back in the chair, his glance happened to rest upon a bell, a disused bell that hung in the room and communicated for some purpose now forgotten with a chamber in the highest story of the building. It was with great astonishment and with a strange, inexplicable dread that as he looked he saw this bell begin to swing. It swung so softly in the outset that it scarcely made a sound, but soon it rang out loudly, and so did every bell in the house. This might have lasted half a minute or a minute, but it seemed an hour. The bells ceased as they had begun, together. They were succeeded by a clanking noise deep down below, as if some person were dragging a heavy chain over the casks in the wine merchant's cellar. Scrooge then remembered to have heard that ghosts in haunted houses were described as dragging chains. The cellar door flew open with a booming sound, and then he heard the noise much louder on the floors below, then coming up the stairs, then coming straight toward his door. "It's humbug still," said Scrooge. "I won't believe it." His color changed, though, when, without a pause, it came on through the heavy door and passed into the room before his eyes. Upon its coming in, the dying flame leaped up as though it cried, "I know him!" Marley's ghost, and fell again. The same face, the very same. The chain he drew was clasped about his middle. It was long and wound about him like a tail, and it was made, for Scrooge observed it closely, of cash boxes, keys, padlocks, ledgers, deeds, and heavy purses wrought in steel. "How now?" said Scrooge, caustic and cold as ever. "What do you want with me?" "Much," Marley's voice, no doubt about it. "Who are you?"
"Ask me who I was."
"Who are you then?" said Scrooge, raising his voice. "You're particular, for a shade." He was going to say, "to a shade," but substituted this, as more appropriate. "In life I was your partner, Jacob Marley."
Can you sit down?" asked Scrooge, looking doubtfully at him.
"I can."
"Do it then."
Scrooge asked the question, because he didn't know whether a ghost so transparent might find himself in a condition to take a chair, and felt that in the event of its being impossible, it might involve the necessity of an embarrassing explanation. But the ghost sat down on the opposite side of the fireplace, as if he were quite used to it. Scrooge fell upon his knees and clasped his hands before his face. "Mercy," he said, "dreadful apparition, why do you trouble me?"
"Man of the worldly mind," replied the ghost, "do you believe in me or not?"
"I do," said Scrooge.
"I must.
But why do spirits walk the earth, and why do they come to me?"
"It is required of every man," the ghost returned, "that the spirit within him should walk abroad among his fellow men, and travel far and wide, and if that spirit goes not forth in life, it is condemned to do so after death. It is doomed to wander through the world, oh woe is me, and witness what it cannot share but might have shared on earth and turned to happiness." The spectre raised a cry and shook its chain and wrung its shadowy hands.
"You are fettered," said Scrooge, trembling.
"Tell me why."
"I wear the chain I forged in life," replied the ghost. "I made it link by link and yard by yard. I girded it on of my own free will, and of my own free will I wore it. Is its pattern strange to you?"
Scrooge trembled more and more.
"Or would you know," pursued the ghost, "the weight and length of the strong coil you bear yourself? It was full as heavy and as long as this, 7 Christmas Eves ago. You have labored on it since. It is a ponderous chain." Scrooge glanced about him on the floor in the expectation of finding himself surrounded by some 50 or 60 fathoms of iron cable, but he could see nothing.
"Jacob," he said imploringly.
"Old Jacob Marley, tell me more. Speak comfort to me, Jacob."
"I have none to give," the ghost replied.
"It comes from other regions, Ebenezer Scrooge, and is conveyed by other ministers to other kinds of men. Nor can I tell you what I would. A very little more is all permitted to me. I cannot rest, I cannot stay, I cannot linger anywhere. My spirit never walked beyond our counting house. Mark me, In life, my spirit never roved beyond the narrow limits of our money-changing hole, and weary journeys lie before me. It was a habit with Scrooge, whenever he became thoughtful, to put his hands in his breeches pockets. Pondering on what the ghost had said, he did so now, but without lifting up his eyes or getting off his knees. "You must have been very slow about it, Jacob," Scrooge observed in a businesslike manner, though with humility and deference. "Slow," the ghost repeated. "7 years dead," mused Scrooge. "And traveling all the time?" "The whole time," said the ghost. "No rest, no peace. Incessant torture of remorse."
"You travel fast," said Scrooge.
"On the wings of the wind," replied the ghost.
"You might have got over a great quantity of ground in 7 years," said Scrooge.
The ghost, on hearing this, set up another cry, and clanked its chain hideously.
"Oh! Captive, bound and double ironed," cried the phantom, "not to know that ages of incessant labor by immortal creatures for this earth must pass into eternity before the good of which it is susceptible is all developed. Not to know that any Christian spirit working kindly in its little sphere, whatever it may be, will find its mortal life too short for its vast means of usefulness. Not to know that no space of regret can make amends for one life's opportunities misused. Yet such was I.
Oh! Such was I."
"But you were always a good man of business, Jacob," faltered Scrooge, who now began to apply this to himself.
"Business," cried the ghost, wringing its hands again. "Mankind was my business. The common welfare was my business. Charity, mercy, forbearance, and benevolence were all my business. The dealings of my trade were but a drop of water in the comprehensive ocean of my business." It held up its chain at arm's length, as if that were the cause of all its unavailing grief, and flung it heavily upon the ground again.
"At this time of the rolling year," the spectre said, "I suffer most. Why did I walk through crowds of fellow beings with my eyes turned down, and never raise them to that blessed star which led the wise men to a poor abode? Were there no poor homes to which its light would have conducted me?"
Scrooge was very much dismayed to hear the spectre going on at this rate, and began to quake exceedingly.
"Hear me," cried the ghost. "My time is nearly gone."
"I will," said Scrooge.
"But don't be hard upon me. Don't be flowery, Jacob. Pray. How it is that I appear before you in a shape that you can see, I may not tell. I have sat invisible beside you many and many a day." It was not an agreeable idea.
Scrooge shivered and wiped the perspiration from his brow.
"That is no light part of my penance," pursued the ghost. "I am here tonight to warn you that you have yet a chance and hope of escaping my fate. A chance and hope of my procuring Ebenezer."
"You are always a good friend to me," said Scrooge.
"Thank ye."
"You will be haunted," resumed the ghost, "by three spirits."
Scrooge's countenance fell.
"Is that the chance and hope you mentioned?"
"Jacob," he demanded in a faltering voice.
"It is."
I think I'd rather not," said Scrooge.
"Without their visits," said the ghost, "you cannot hope to shun the path I tread. Expect the first tomorrow, when the bell tolls one."
"Couldn't I take 'em all at once, and have it over, Jacob?" hinted Scrooge.
"Expect the second on the next night at the same hour. The third upon the next night when the last stroke of 12 has ceased to vibrate. Look to see me no more, and look that, for your own sake, you remember what has passed between us." The apparition walked backward from him toward the window, and floated out upon the bleak dark night. Scrooge followed to the window, desperate in his curiosity. He looked out. The air was filled with phantoms, wandering hither and thither in restless haste and moaning as they went. Every one of them wore chains like Marley's ghost. Some few, they might be guilty governments, were linked together, none were free. Many had been personally known to Scrooge in their lives. He had been quite familiar with one old ghost, in a white waistcoat, with a monstrous iron safe attached to its ankle, who cried piteously at being unable to assist a wretched woman with an infant, whom it saw below upon a doorstep. The misery with them all was, clearly, that they sought to interfere for good in human matters, and had lost the power forever. Whether these creatures faded into mist, or mist enshrouded them, he could not tell. But they and their spirit voices faded together, and the night became as it had been when he walked home. Scrooge closed the window, and examined the door by which the ghost had entered. It was double-locked, as he had locked it with his own hands, and the bolts were undisturbed. He tried to say humbug, but stopped at the first syllable. And being from the emotion he had undergone, or the fatigues of the day, or his glimpse of the invisible world, or the dull conversation of the ghost, or the lateness of the hour much in need of repose, went straight to bed without undressing, and fell asleep upon the instant. Stave 2. The First of the Three Spirits. When Scrooge awoke, it was so dark that, looking out of bed, he could scarcely distinguish the transparent window from the opaque walls of his chamber. He was endeavoring to pierce the darkness with his ferret eyes when the chimes of a neighboring church clock struck 12. "Why, it isn't possible," said Scrooge, "that I couldn't have slept through a whole day and far into another night." Scrooge lay and thought it over and over, and could make nothing of it. The more he thought, the more perplexed he was, and the more he endeavored not to think, the more he thought. Marley's ghost bothered him exceedingly. Was it a dream or not? Scrooge lay in this state until he remembered, on a sudden, that the ghost had warned him of a visitation when the bell tolled one. He resolved to lie awake until the hour was past, and considering that he could not go to sleep, this was perhaps the wisest resolution in his power. He was more than once convinced he must have sunk into a doze unconsciously and missed the clock. At length it broke upon his listening ear. "The hour itself," said Scrooge triumphantly, "nothing else." He spoke before the hour bell sounded, which it now did with a deep, dull, hollow, melancholy one. Light flashed up in the room upon the instant, and the curtains of his bed were drawn. The curtains of his bed were drawn aside, I tell you, by a hand. Not the curtains at his feet, nor the curtains at his back, but those to which his face was addressed. The curtains of his bed were drawn aside, and Scrooge, starting up into a half-recumbent attitude, found himself face to face with the visitor who drew them. It was a strange figure, like a child, yet not so like a child as like an old man, viewed through some supernatural medium, which gave him the appearance of having receded from the view and being diminished to a child's proportions. Its hair, which hung about its neck and down its back, was white as if with age, and yet the face had not a wrinkle in it, and the tenderest bloom was on the skin. The arms were very long and muscular, the hands the same, as if its hold were of uncommon strength. Its legs and feet, most delicately formed, were, like those upper members, bare. It wore a tunic of the purest white, and round its waist was bound a lustrous belt, the sheen of which was beautiful. It held a branch of fresh green holly in its hand, and in singular contradiction of that wintry emblem, had its dress trimmed with summer flowers. But the strangest thing about it was that from the crown of its head there sprung a bright clear jet of light, by which all this was visible, and which was doubtless the occasion of its using in its duller moments a great extinguisher for a cap, which it now held under its arm. "Are you the spirit, sir, whose coming was foretold to me?" asked Scrooge. "I am." The voice was soft and gentle. Singularly low, as if instead of being so close beside him, it were at a distance. "Who and what are you?" Scrooge demanded. "I am the ghost of Christmas past."
"Long past?"
inquired Scrooge, observant of its dwarfish stature.
"No. Your past."
Scrooge then made bold to inquire what business brought him there.
"Your welfare," said the ghost.
Scrooge expressed himself much obliged, but could not help thinking that a night of unbroken rest would have been more conducive to that end. The spirit must have heard him thinking, for it said immediately,
"Your reclamation, then.
Take heed." It put out its strong hand as it spoke, and clasped him gently by the arm.
"Rise and walk with me." It would have been in vain for Scrooge to plead that the weather and the hour were not adapted to pedestrian purposes, that bed was warm and the thermometer a long way below freezing, that he was clad but lightly in his slippers, dressing gown, and nightcap, and that he had a cold upon him at the time. The grasp, though gentle as a woman.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.